Hello, this is Dr. Glasbrenner from George Mason University, and in this video, we will learn about the purpose and structure of hypothesis tests by drawing an analogy between them and a trial in a court of law. In our last video, we reviewed data that was collected during a gender discrimination experiment that, without further analysis, left us with two plausible and competing claims for interpreting the meaning of the results. One claim is that there is nothing going on. If this claim is correct, then that means that promotion and gender are independent, there was no gender discrimination, and any observed difference in proportions were simply due to chance. We label this claim as the null hypothesis. The other claim is that there is something going on. If this claim is correct, then that means that promotion and gender are dependent, there was gender discrimination, and the observed difference in proportions was not due to chance. We label this claim as the alternative hypothesis. The process of conducting a hypothesis test is analogous to the procedures followed in a fair court trial. The null hypothesis in a court trial is that the defendant is innocent, and the alternative hypothesis is that the defendant is guilty. The presentation of evidence by the prosecution and the defense serves a similar purpose to the data that is collected by a scientific researcher during an experiment. After all the evidence has been reviewed, we then need to render a judgment on the question, could these data plausibly have happened by chance if the null hypothesis were true? If it's very unlikely that chance alone could generate our evidence, then this raises more than a reasonable doubt about the plausibility of the null hypothesis. However, there are many times in both court cases and scientific experiments that the evidence is less clear, and you will have trouble deciding if the more than a reasonable doubt threshold has been crossed. Put another way, if we say something is unlikely, just how unlikely is it? How much uncertainty are we willing to tolerate when rejecting the null hypothesis? After defining the more than a reasonable doubt threshold, if the evidence is not strong enough to reject the assumption of innocence, the jury returns with a verdict of not guilty. Note that the jury does not say that the defendant is innocent, just that there is not enough evidence to convict. The defendant may, in fact, be innocent, but the jury has no way of being sure. In statistical parlance, we would say that we failed to reject the null hypothesis. It is worth emphasizing that this methodology will never allow us to declare that the null hypothesis is true, and therefore, we never should conclude that we accept the null hypothesis. This ties back to the lecture video about the scientific method and falsification, where I made the statement that science experiments cannot prove something to be true. They can only falsify hypotheses. This is why in a court trial, the burden of proof is on the prosecution, and in a hypothesis test, the burden of proof is on the unusual claim. In this framework, the null hypothesis is the ordinary state of affairs or status quo, so it's the alternative hypothesis that we consider unusual and for which we must gather evidence. Of course, for our work, these ideas will only be useful if we have a way to quantify the null hypothesis. The next video demonstrates how you can do this with nothing more than a deck of playing cards.